bold, engaged in a complex learning network. Good morning to one and all gathered here virtually. I, Dr. Mahalakshmi, on behalf of the Anand Sagar University and BITES, the Board of IT Education Standard, Government of Karnataka, welcome you all. It's a great honor and immense pleasure to be here with you all for the 9th celebrities and celebrations called CAC lecture on Joseph Fourier, the Analyst by Professor Vittal Rao, former Professor of Mathematics, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Thank you all for joining us this morning. Your presence here is not only in joyous celebration, but it is an expression of your interest in celebrating the celebrities. Joseph Fourier, one among us, the celebrity, and celebrated for his contribution towards Fourier analysis and harmonic analysis and their applications to problems of heat transfer and vibrations. The Fourier transform and Fourier law of conduction are also named in his honor. Fourier is also generally credited with the discovery of greenhouse effect. I take this privilege to brief you about the Anand Sagar University and BITES for a second. The Anand Sagar University is backed by a 6-decade legacy in education and healthcare. The Anand Sagar University, DSU, established by Mahatma Gandhi Vidyapeetha Trust as a state-private university in Karnataka. DSU is envisioned to be a research and innovation-focused university mentored by Dr. Hemchandra Sagar, Chancellor, and Dr. Premchandra Sagar, Pro-Chancellor. DSU has been established with the sole purpose of offering high-quality education through world-class infrastructure, a dedicated qualified faculty, employability-oriented curriculum, and ample opportunities for learning industry-driven innovation lab. The Board of IT Education Standard, called BITES, is an autonomous body and a non-profit society promoted by the Government of Karnataka in association with educational institutions and IT industries in Karnataka in order to enhance the quality of IT education and help build quality manpower for the IT industry. I kindly request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, the Anand Sagar University, and the Chairman, BITES, the Board of IT Education and Standards, Dr. K.N.V. Murthy, to welcome the virtual gathering, followed by introduction of our distinguished chief guest, Dr. Professor Vittal Rao, former professor, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Please, sir.
Yeah. Good morning, Dr. Mahalakshmi. Thank you for nice introduction. It's my pleasure to introduce Professor Vittal Rao. Professor Vittal Rao has a MSc degree in mathematics from University of Mysore and PhD degree in mathematics from Purdue University, USA. He was a faculty in the Department of Mathematics at IISc for more than 3 decades, served as a professor and chairman of the department. Since his retirement, he is associated with the Department of Electronic Systems Engineering at IISc. He has held visiting faculty positions at Purdue University, Iowa State University, USA. Visiting scientist at the International Center for Theoretical Physics at Trieste, Italy, association with the Department of Civil and Hydraulic Engineering, Department of Computer Science and Automation at IISc, and Department of Mathematics at IIT Madras. He specializes in the areas of analysis, linear algebra, applications of mathematics. He enjoys teaching mathematics and is the recipient of Teaching Excellence Award at IISc. Before I request Professor Vittal Rao, I would request Professor Jamadagni to say a few words about the CAC lecture series. Jamadagni, sir.
Oh, I was not prepared for this. Anyway, this series of lectures, which is mainly sponsored by BITES, it's called Celebration and Celebrities, or Celebrities and Celebration, whichever way you want to put it. The idea was that there are so many celebrities in science, engineering, art, and many others, that many of these pioneers in science and mathematics and engineering and so on, I think they get forgotten by our modern whole education system in the problem, in sort of trying to catch up with what is happening and so on. So the idea was that preferably on the day of birth of some of these celebrities, we hold a 1 hour kind of a lecture on these people, trying to highlight what have they done and what is their major contribution, and then how have they done. The main criteria for, let's say main criterion for being considered a celebrity is that they must have made a lasting impact in their corresponding fields. So a person like Fourier, for instance, is chosen, and then somebody like Professor Vittal Rao, who knows Fourier's work very well, is then requested to make give a talk on this. And the highlights of this talk is that we first of all highlight what this person was. Then we say what is the contribution of the person, whether it is scientific, mathematical, engineering. We try to highlight the impact of the work that was done. And very importantly, we also try to bring out what are the circumstances in which he worked. Remember that in many universities and many other workplaces, we always complain about the working conditions. So we want to just highlight also as the working conditions under which many of these people work, and to really show that many a times the genius that comes out with a lot of results will have circumstances which are even 100 to what we have today. And so to trying to find out what they have done, and then how have they referred to the previous work, and how rebellious they were in introducing some new ideas, and what are the difficulties they faced in actually propagating their ideas, and how much time did it take for the world to absorb, use, and then start praising the person that who invented this. For instance, in the case of Fourier and other mathematicians, it is a 150 years of struggle people had to really understand them fully and then use it for various purposes. So this is the whole idea. Celebrity, how did he work? What, what are the circumstances under which he worked? And then how did this work actually impact the world? Sir, Professor Vittal Rao, over to you on Joseph Fourier.
Yeah, thank you very much. Before I start the lecture, a small question. Who is operating the slides?
I am operating. Jamadagni is operating.
Okay, Professor Jamadagni, then I think I don't have to say next slide.
Yeah.
I think automatically understand the next slide.
By and large.
Yeah, if there is any problem, we will worry. Okay, because my slides are one line per this thing has to be changed.
Yeah.
So as I read, you will know what we have to do. Okay. Right. Thank you very much. We have started, due to some technical difficulties, we have started a little late. So I do not know whether I will take the full hour or not. Maybe somewhere at the middle, I will cut if necessary, if everybody has to go by 10:30. So somebody give me a cue when to stop. Okay. Otherwise, I'll go on talking. Right. As Professor Jamadagni said, there are several aspects that one have to cover. I may not cover them in the same order, but some of them I may not even cover. I will start my lecture without much ado. This talk is about Jean-Baptiste Joseph Fourier. He was born on March 21st, 1768, and he lived up to May 16th, 1830. This lecture was supposed to have been given on March 21st. Okay, Okay. He was a French scientist, and he was an 18th century scientist. Well, as you know, Newton had led the world of science smoothly into the 18th century, and the 18th century radiated a very special kind of genius, and it produced some great men in all fields, just to mention a few: Mozart, Euler, Benjamin Franklin, etc. But the French had their own share of producing great scientists and mathematicians. I have listed a number of scientists, famous scientists here: Lavoisier, Fresnel, Cornell, Hollombert, Laplace, Legendre, Poisson, Navier, and Cauchy, and many more. Yes, the next one, please. Many of the scientists walked through a slippery path through the politics of the French Revolution towards the end of the 18th century, and many of them paid a very heavy price. Lavoisier is a great example, who was sent to the guillotine by the Revolutionary Committee at the age of 50, at the peak of his career. Lagrange was very much upset, and he made the following comment. He said, "It took them only one moment to kill him, but even if we give them 100 years, they will not be able to reproduce another Lavoisier."
Yes, actually, in French, it sounds extremely nice.
Yes. I deliberately put the French one because I knew that you could, and there'll be somebody else also who would like to read the original statement. It's a beautiful way this has been expressed by Lagrange in the history. So it was, Lagrange was a man who did not participate much in the revolution. He was a very quiet person, but he was also very much upset by this. But what is interesting is the judge who tried Lavoisier in the case made the following comment. The Republic has no need of scientists or chemists. The course of justice cannot be stopped, or something like that. And so this is the background in which most of the scientists at that time in France worked. But who is Fourier? Well, in the border of Fourier's tomb in Paris, the following words are written. Again, I put the original French one, and the bottom you have the English one. The profound mathematician, elegant writer, upright administrator, good citizen, and a devout friend. So he was all this and much more. Okay. So Fourier had a very peculiar character in himself. So the greatest contribution he made to science was the theory of heat conduction. In 1804, he began his work, and in 1807, he completed his first paper, and it was titled On the Propagation of Heat in Solid Bodies. He presented it, something about this paper, a comment. This paper, like any other masterpiece, has broken all rules. It led him where logic had a hard time following, offended many great mathematicians, and he had to fight for 15 years to get it published. It got published finally in 1822. It is now one of the most classic works ever written. He presented it first to the Institute de France and on December 21st, 1807. And the committee consisted of some big names like Lagrange, Laplace, Monge, Lacroix. And today this is one of the highly regarded memoirs, but at that time, the committee raised two major objections. The objections were the following. Lagrange and Laplace raised several questions about the expansion in trigonometric series, which today we call as Fourier series. Then there was this other guy, the physicist Bayeux, who bothered Fourier all his lifetime. He objected to the fact that his earlier paper was not referred to. And later, Laplace and Poisson also joined in this objection. But should be noted that Bayeux's paper was in fact incorrect. Again, in 1811, the Institute announced this as a prize competition subject. Fourier submitted his memoir with some additional work. The committee this time consisted of the three big L's, Lagrange, Laplace, and Legendre, together with two more people. And Fourier was awarded the prize, but the recommendations were not completely favorable to Fourier. I'll read a sentence from the committee's report. The manner in which the author arrives at the equation is not exempt of difficulties, and that his analysis to integrate them still leaves something to be desired on the score of generality and even rigor. I want to emphasize on the word integrate, because integration, particularly the concept of definite integral, was at the stage of infancy at that time. People didn't know much about definite integrals. It had to wait for a few more years for Riemann to come into the picture and then bring in all the ideas of definite integrals, the so-called Riemann integrals, which was further strengthened in the beginning of the 20th century by Lagrange. So in short, somebody wrote that the Fourier heat conduction equation was crowned, but Fourier series was considered a disgrace. We can have a good laugh at it, but that is what was said at that time. So Fourier didn't have an easy time. Let's keep going. Yes. Next, please. Yeah. Well, so what is the Fourier series? What was Fourier's claim? I'll make a very simple statement on Fourier series. If you have a periodic function with period 2 pi, then you can expand it in a series like this, and it is called trigonometric series because the cosine and sine are involved, and you can replace cosine and sine by the exponentials and write the series in the terms of exponential series. And what are the coefficients? And Fourier gave the formula for the coefficients fns 0 to 2 pi fxn. And the question that was raised was question one, For which class of functions are these integrals defining the coefficients well defined? Again, repeat the fact that integration was at its infancy stage. And therefore, people worried whenever they wrote a definite integral, what do you mean by this? How do you know it exists? Is it properly defined? And so on and so forth. These questions were raised to Fourier. The second one was, okay, I grant you that you have given me the conditions. The integrals exist. Therefore, the Fourier coefficients are known. Therefore, I can write the series. But how do I know that the series converges? That was the next question. What are your conditions for convergence? The third question that I said, okay, I give you the Fourier coefficients are defined. Therefore, you write the series. I give you the fact that it converges. How do I know that it converges to f of x? So these were the three fundamental questions that were raised. The first major breakthrough in answering this, Fourier did not have much answer for these questions. So therefore, people had to work later. The first major breakthrough came for a class of functions called piecewise smooth functions. The word is very clear. The function is divided into a number of pieces and each piece is smooth. So there are only a finite number of discontinuities. At each discontinuity, it has both right and left limits, and at all other points is differentiable. For example, it's like a curve like this. There are three pieces and each piece is nice smooth. At the joining point, there are discontinuities, but both the right left limits exist. Such functions are called smooth functions. Dirichlet in 1829 proved that a theorem that for such piecewise smooth functions, Fourier coefficients exist, and therefore we can write the Fourier series, and it converges at all points, and it converges to the value to which is the average of the two right and left limits. At a point of continuity, both the right and left limits are the same, and therefore at a point of continuity, the Fourier series will definitely converge to the function. A word about Dirichlet. Dirichlet was a young child, sort of a prodigy. At the age of 17 or 18, he had a proof of the Fermat's last theorem for a special case. So the French Academy had invited him to give a talk at that young age. I think he did not even have a doctorate at that time. Probably was a very special case who was invited to the French Academy to lecture at that young age. And it was then that Dirichlet got familiar with Fourier, personally familiar with Fourier. And Fourier became one of the mentors for Dirichlet. Okay. Now, Karslaw, in his book in 1906 on Fourier series and integrals, make the following comment. Dirichlet is generally credited with the first concrete convergence proof of the series. However, his proof was nearly identical to the proof of Fourier himself in his original treatise. Now, the reason for this may be that Fourier's memoir took, though he presented the paper first in 1807, then again in 1811, it was published only in 1822. So probably people had forgotten about this and did not take much interest in it in proving theorems. When Dirichlet came in contact with Fourier during his visit to the academy, probably he had an access to Fourier's manuscript and he saw the proof and put things in the right language and things like that and gave the proof. Therefore, according to Karslaw, though it is credited to, the proof is credited to Dirichlet, most of it is due to Fourier himself. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, now the several theorems that followed after Dirichlet were all had one common feature. The common feature was the smoother your function, the better the convergence. The rate of convergence may be better, the type of convergence may be better, and so on and so forth. That is the main theme of the future research. Now we come to the developments in the 20th century where things get better organized. Lebesgue introduced the Lebesgue integrals, and therefore the classical Banach spaces or the classical Lebesgue spaces were defined. Those are functions whose peak power has a finite integral. And those are called the LP spaces. Two special ones are the L1 and L2, which most of the time engineers deals with. L1 is roughly stable, if you want to use stable functions or stable signals, and the second one are the finite energy signals in the interval 0 to 2 pi. Okay. Now, some observations. If you have a function which is summable or absolutely summable, its Fourier coefficients are well defined, and therefore we can write the Fourier coefficients. And secondly, for p greater than 1, whenever it is p integrable, it is also 1 integrable. So if you prove some theorems for L1, it will be automatically varied for Lp. And therefore, if we now have a p function, it will also be in one function. For one function, the Fourier series are all well defined, and therefore for the p functions are also, the Fourier series are all well defined. So as far as the definition of the Fourier series, the question was well settled that for all Lp functions, all functions in the standard classical spaces, the Fourier series are all well defined. The series is well defined. But therefore, the question was, what about convergence and convergence to F? Now, the natural thing is, since the P functions are all in one function, if you prove a theorem for one function, convergence for one function, they are automatically valid for P functions also. So the natural question will be the following. If you have a one function, does the Fourier series converge to Fx? This was the first attempt that was made in the early 20th century. Then came Kolmogorov, the famous Russian scientist. He gave a stunning result in 1926. He constructed a one function, L1 function, for which the Fourier series does not converge at any point. In fact, therefore, Kolmogorov destroyed Fourier's claim completely. Go back, please. Go back. So Kolmogorov completely destroyed Fourier's dream in the sense that Fourier's original claim was that every periodic function can be expanded in a trigonometric series. And here is Kolmogorov, who produced a function which is nice, integrable, whose Fourier series is well defined, but the Fourier series, there is no question of it converging to Fx because it does not even converge at any point. And therefore, there was a gloom in Fourier analysis in that sense. People started doubting Fourier very seriously. So the next question was, but P function, okay, L1 failed, what about Lp? So that was the next question. Does the Fourier series of Lp functions converge to F? The simplest Lp space is L2, yes? The question therefore was, does the Fourier series of a finite energy fellow converge to the Fourier function? And the first easy result was the so-called root mean square convergence. So if you have a finite energy fellow, then the Fourier series converges in the root. Look at this. There is a square root at the exterior. The integral is the average. So you put the uniform distribution on 0 to pi, and therefore the mean will be an integral, the expected value, and the absolute value square. So mean square, the square of the error between the function and the finite sum, the finite sum approximation, that will go to 0. So therefore, we have RMS convergence for L2. The generalizations were, these can be further extended. Instead of trigonometric functions, we could choose general orthonormal sets. You can even talk about Fourier. I should mention here that the first 30 or 40 years of the 20th century was a golden period for real analysis. I think that's when some beautiful theorems on real analysis were proved. And these results were all extended to general idea of Fourier series in a Hilbert space. And we could talk much more than that. And correspondingly, the elder brother or the twin brother of the Fourier series, the Fourier transform, from the discrete to the continuous, from the periodic to the non-periodic, Fourier Plancherel proved exact version of how Fourier transform should be defined for finite energy signal. This is called the Fourier Plancherel theorem. Now comes the very important breakthrough, 150 years of Fourier. All these theorems were about RMS convergence. What about convergence at a point? At a given point, x, yes, Now here I want to make a comment before we move further. The point-wise convergence, we must always go back and remember what Dirichlet said. Dirichlet said you will have convergence, but there will be problem at points of discontinuity. He said you will have discontinuity at that point. The series doesn't know where to go, right limit, left limit, or maybe the right limit does not even exist, and so on. So point-wise convergence will have some problem at some points. Therefore, whenever we ask for point-wise convergence, we must say except at some exceptional points. But as Dirichlet had only a finite number of points, we would like to have these exceptional points to be reasonably under control. And that is what Leonard Carlson proved in 1966. He proved the theorem that if we have a finite energy thing, then the Fourier series converges to X almost surely. In probability language, it is almost surely. In real analysis language, it is almost everywhere. What it means is the points at which the convergence to Fx does not take place has probability zero. I'll make a few comments about Carlson before I go to Richard Hunt. Go back. Carlson proved this theorem in 1966. Carlson was a very fine harmonic analyst. I expected that he would have got the Fields Medal for this theorem, but he didn't. But eventually he got the Abel Prize in 2006 for his contributions in harmonic analysis. Another important thing that I would like to mention in my personal memory about this theorem is, it was in 1966 when this theorem was proved, before it came in publication, early in January 1966, I was a graduate student at Purdue University at that time. And I was taking a course on analysis from a very, very fine analyst, Caspar Goffman, Professor Caspar Goffman, who was himself has made great contributions in Fourier series and Fourier analysis. So his classes always used to be at 8 o'clock in the morning. And most of the time in that winter, I would miss all the morning classes except Goffman's class. I would definitely reach my office by 7:30 and wait to go to Goffman's class. And one of these days, early January, when I was in my office, Professor Goffman knocked at my door and he entered and said, "Rao, I need some help. Before you go to the class, you please come to my room 5 minutes earlier." Then I went to his room and there were two cardboard boxes. And he said that I would like you to help me carry one of these boxes to the class. So he carried the other box, I carried one. The one I carried, I chose the one which was heavier, and so that that elderly person could, professor could carry the lighter one. But all the time going down the lift, I was wondering that there are some test papers in that, and we are going to take a surprise test, and I was a little scared because I was not all that prepared. So when we went to the class, the two boxes were kept on the table, and Goffman sat on the bench on the table, and as usual, before he starts anything, he would light a cigar. He lighted the cigar, took a puff and said, "We are going to celebrate today." And then he announced that the Carlson's theorem gave us 5 minutes, a quick what the history is and what the theorem is. And he asked me to open the box. The lighter box had a nice plastic container full of donuts, and the other box had Coca-Cola cans. So we celebrated in the class the proof of Carlson's theorem with donuts and Coca-Cola. And of course, he apologized that the cans are only Coca-Cola and not beer cans, and that whoever wants to celebrate with beer can come to his house in the evening. Of course, we all went to his house in the evening. So that's my personal connection with the proof of the Carlson's theorem. Unfortunately, Goffman passed away about 10, 15 years back. He was a wonderful teacher. He always used to say that I am primarily a teacher, though he has a lot of PhD students. Okay, next. So now, Carlson having settled the theorem for L2 functions, the next question was only about LP functions. What about for p not equal to 2, does the Fourier series converge? And this theorem was settled by a very young mathematician by name Richard Hunt. At that time, he was only 31 years old. He was born in 1937. And he showed that for LP functions also, the same result like Carlson quotes. Again, a personal connection. Richard Hunt, after Richard Hunt received the Salem Prize for this proof, as soon as he proved this theorem, that was during his postdoctoral work, he was appointed as a faculty at Purdue University. So again, I had a personal interaction with him. As a young man, he was only about three and a half years older than me. So he connected with some of our senior graduate students better with them, with probably faculty. So he used to come with us several times for lunch. He's a wonderful person, clear thinking and clear expressions. And I could see how we could immediately see how Carlson's results could be extended to LP. So this is the summary of, let's go back. This is the summary of the history of Fourier series. It started with Fourier series claim by Fourier, and then the three questions raised by the committee and the struggle to answer those, find the answer to those questions, started with Dirichlet, and then doubts were created by Kolmogorov. Then things were clear by Carlson and Richard Hunt, and now it is well settled that for all reasonable functions, of all functions in the standard classical spaces, the Fourier series converges to the function almost surely. So Fourier was, after all, was not that far away from the truth. Okay. So yes, next please. So that is the quick review of the history of Fourier series, history of the mathematics that grew, that was developed from the seeds that Fourier had shown. Now, the question is, there has always been a debate, was Fourier a mathematician or a physicist? These type of questions have been widely debated and argued upon by physicists and mathematicians, and what one says will depend on their ideas, their arrogance, their character, and their specialities. I will refer to a book in this context. There is a beautiful book by Galileo. It's called The Dialogue Between Two Universes. This book is about a dialogue. Yes, this keep it here for a while. This dialogue is about the two universes, namely the Copernican model of heliocentric universe, which Galileo was very sure that is the right one, and the earlier one, the Ptolemyan universe of the geocentric universe. Okay, so Galileo wrote a book to describe the two universes and their dialogue between them. And in this book, there are two characters. One is the Salviati. He is supposed to be Galileo, so Galileo speaks through Salviati. And the other fellow is Simplicio, who represents Ptolemy. Okay. So Simplicio, who represents Ptolemy, recommends to keep students away from mathematics, as it makes bad philosophy. It makes you mind too captious and lets you forget the primacy of the phenomena. This is simply that essentially Ptolemy speaking through Simplicio not to give too much importance to mathematics. Now for that, Salviati, that is Galileo, speaks through Salviati and said, yes, this is a correct advice that you fellow should give, because if you teach this, the unfortunate thing is the science, the mathematics is science which so efficiently, go back please, which so efficiently would detect your teacher's fallacies and wrong reasoning. So therefore, you Ptolemyers, if you had taught mathematics to your students, then they would have found out all the mistakes you are committing and the errors in your logic, and therefore it is so good that you don't teach them mathematics. But if you want your students to learn properly logic and correct reasoning, do teach them mathematics. So this is a beautiful book where he says physics cannot go without mathematics, and mathematics has to be with physics. Okay, Fourier in his expresses his ideas about this physics, mathematics, and discoveries very nicely. here are some quotes. The thorough study of nature is the most fertile ground of mathematical discoveries. It describes next about analytical equations. You can read it for yourselves. Next, no language can be as universal and simple. And then the next one, please. It about mathematical analysis. Its main feature is clarity, not made to express confused notions, unites the most diverse phenomenon, discovers most secret notions, and so on. And finally, is meant to supply the brevity of life and the imperfection of our senses. So it's very clear that Fourier wanted to be a mathematician. Right. Now, quickly, a brief biography of Fourier. Early years, the first 17 years, he was born, as I said, on March 21st. The place of birth was Auxerre. Jamadagni, the next slide is for you. If you ever go to Paris, it's only 160 kilometers drive from Paris to southeast of Paris, and about 150 kilometers west of Orleans. So just drop in, maybe you will see some of the nice places connected with Fourier there. Okay, right. Next, please. So he is not from a well-to-do family. His father was a tailor, mother was a homemaker. And his father had 3 children from the first marriage, 13 children from the second marriage. Fourier was the 9th of the 13 children from the second marriage. And he lost his parents by the time he was 10. Okay, his early education, he went to the Ecole Royale Military School. This was run by the Benedictine monks, church. And there he learned French, Latin, science, and mathematics. He found the textbook of Bezout, a course of mathematics in 6 volumes, and Clairaut, elements of geometry. So he developed his interest from these 2 books. Every genius seems to have been inspired by one book or the other, like Ramanujan got his inspiration in Carr's book. Okay. Then, hold it for here for a while. Now, having come out of a training from a Royal Military School run by the church, Fourier had only 2 choices for further education. One was either to join the army, because he came from a military school, or you try to get trained as a priest. So, Legendre recommendation, go back, please. Legendre recommended that he join the army because in the artillery he could do some science. So therefore, Legendre recommended Fourier to the army, and the Minister of War replied to Legendre rejecting Fourier to the army. And his reply read like this. Yes, please. That is the French version. Yeah. It said that even if Fourier were the second Newton, that's so great in science, I cannot admit him to the army because he is not from nobility. He is not from a noble background. So that was the day people were selected in the army in those days. So he was rejected. So therefore, Fourier had no choice but to join, to train himself as a priest. So he joins an abbey in near Orleans to take his vows. And he expresses his disappointment in a letter to one of his friends as follows. Yesterday was my 21st birthday. At that age, Newton and Pascal had already acquired many claims to immortality. It shows that he wanted to do science, but unfortunately for him, he was in getting trained to be a priest. Yes. So considering his interest in mathematics, he continued his reading. And somebody remarked that the devil of mathematics has taken over the soul of Fourier. But luckily, there was a divine intervention on November 2nd. 3 days before he was supposed to take the oaths, the assembly, National Assembly, suspended all religious oaths. So therefore, Fourier comes out without taking the oaths for a priest. And luckily, he comes out of the abbey, and we got a good scientist for us. Okay, after the abbey, he goes back to teach in the same school as Auxerre, where he studied as a humanities teacher, and because of his training in the church and all. And life appeared to be quite quiet without much involvement in public affairs until the revolution, the Louis XVI was executed in 1793, and he gets involved, and you can skip some of these things. So he gets arrested a couple of times. You can skip this also. And so Puri gets arrested a couple of times, goes to jail, and he was even escapes being sent to the guillotine a couple of times. Yeah, next slide, please. Yeah, so he escaped being, yeah. Then he finally, go back, in 1994, after all this escape from being jailed and being beheaded, he comes back to Auxerre with a very peculiar position called state paid teacher. That means his salary came from the government, that's all. And that means a safe position, like our jobs, okay. Now the decisive moment in his academic career comes in 1994, October, when the Ecole Normale was created. Yes. And Fourier was selected to attend the Ecole Normale. And he goes there and he is trained by Lagrange, Laplace, and many, Monge particularly was his mentor. What I will do is, now I will skip a few things. You keep going, I will tell you where to stop, okay? Oh, you go back. And I think you made a comment about the facilities that we have and next, the previous one. Yes, see, the lecture halls were poor acoustics. It was hard to hear and be heard, but the lectures were superb. Students were very well ill-prepared, and except Fourier, the teachers were Lagrange, Laplace, Monge, and Berthelet, okay? And yes, and Fourier's comments about his teachers, Lagrange was the first among the European men of science, Laplace was not that great according to him, and Monge was his real mentor. He had a lot of interaction with Monge, a lot of it is recorded. Okay, now you keep, I'll just put the last one, I will, keep going, yes. This is how Arago, the biographer, describes, the way people used to teach as teachers, probably with all the online mess that is going on now. This is a very important thing, what Arago observes, that reading well-prepared lectures, etc., is totally not permitted. The authorities even took it in writing to them that never to recite any lectures that they were learnt by heart. It is totally out of questions. Yes, next please. And then Tribune, where professor identified, so to speak, with his audience, sees the audience in their loop, looks at their gestures and their countenance. Sometimes he will go at the faster speed. Sometimes he will backtrack. Sometimes he will put things in different language. And this was a totally different atmosphere of teaching. But all this was eventually perfectly recorded by, there were specially put shorthand writers who took all the notes and then circulated it to all the 1,500 students and other places. Okay. This is a brilliant statement about by Arago on Fourier as a teacher. The brilliant success of Fourier as a teacher, keep going. And here is the last sentence which I will read. Fourier had left there a venerated name and the reputation of a professor, distinguished by clarity, method, and erudition. This last sentence is very interesting, particularly as a mathematician. I shall add even the reputation of a professor full of grace, for our colleague has proved that this kind of merit may not be foreign to the teaching of mathematics. What he means was, mathematicians generally do not have grace, do not have clarity, do not have method, do not have erudition. They are crazy fellows. But here is Fourier. He shows that this kind of merit may not be foreign even to the teaching of mathematics. Okay. That's a very important, he was a great teacher. Yes, you can, maybe because we are very close to 10:30. Subsequently, Napoleon sends him to Egypt and he does a lot of work on Egypt, and he becomes an expert on Egyptology. Keep going. Now I will skip several things. I think these are the later we will look at all this. We will have a discussion of all these things in a later. Yeah, keep going. further. Yeah, even this. Yeah, I think now because of time, I will skip all these things. Yeah, now here is back to Paris. Finally, after all the mess, he returns to Paris in 1815 without no job. And he continued his mathematical research, published several papers in pure and applied mathematics. Yes. And he had a madness about heat. His work on heat. I was told by someone that Linus Pauling had this madness about vitamin C. Vitamin C is the panacea for all things. You take vitamin C, will get be cured of everything. Yeah. So I think Fourier had this madness about heat. Heat is the cure for everything, according to him. I think after his work on heat conduction. So he always used to wear very warm clothing. He overheated his apartment. Very hot his apartment used to be. And finally, once coming down the steps, he fell down. And finally, he died on May 16th, 1830. So it's last comments. One of the men of sciences who has shed the brightest luster upon. So now, here is the last part of my lecture. Yes. Did Fourier get enough credit for his mathematics? When the Eiffel Tower was built, 72 names of scientists were etched on that, and Fourier's name was one of them. Yes, next one, please. Yeah, there is Fourier's name. Yeah, please. That is Fourier's name in the middle. At the same time, Fourier's reputation increased in the world after his death, but it seemed to decrease in France itself. For example, neither Arago, please, in his obituary, nor another fellow by name Cousin in his obituary mentioned anything about his mathematics, never paid any tribute to his mathematics. In the famous novel, La Miserable, however it is pronounced, keep this side. He makes comment about two Fouriers. First one, he says, there was a celebrated Fourier in the Academy of Sciences whom posterity has forgotten. And in the some attic, some obscure Fourier is there whom the future will remember. Unfortunately, what Hugo says, the person who will be forgotten is our mathematician Fourier. And the person who thinks he in future will become famous is a philosopher Fourier. But actually what happened really was the reverse. The mathematician Fourier became famous in the future, and the philosopher Fourier, everybody forgot. Now the fact of the fact is this novel was written in 1862, which means 30 years after Fourier died. Now the fact that Hugo mentions that the person who was celebrated in the academy in 1830s has been forgotten. That means Fourier has been forgotten in 1862 in France. Nobody seemed to have even remembered Fourier in France in 1862. Yes, next one, please. Again, when Darboux wrote out the collected works of Fourier, he ignored several contributions of Fourier, like linear programming, etc. And he said, because exaggerated importance Fourier gave to this. Yeah, skip this. Of course, skip this. Of course, now we know. Next one. Yeah, now we know that Fourier series and Fourier analysis is applied all over the place. Whatever subject you are doing, in mathematical language, if you want to say, the legacy of Fourier is almost unbounded. Yes, next one. Fourier's ideas are typical of what Eugene Wigner calls the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics. You do some mathematics somewhere and it becomes applicable somewhere. Yes. The last comment I want to make is, with the benefit of two centuries, we think when Fourier said that every periodic function, go back a little bit. With every periodic function of 2π can be expanded in a trigonometric series, and faced all the criticism from Lagrange, and probably he bit more than he could chew. But then as Robert Browning says, but a man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what is a heaven for? And because Fourier dared to reach beyond his grasp, today we have reached the heavens that he was reaching for. And it's now for us to reach for heavens beyond our grasp so that the future generations can reach those heavens. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'll stop here, exactly 10:30.
Great. Okay. One coincidence, yes. While we should have had the Fourier's birthday on the spring equinox, we have it instead on the fall equinox.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly 180 degrees opposite in phase, and I'm sure that he will be very appreciative of this. Exactly 180 degrees opposite.
Yes, exactly, yes. Yeah. Any questions? Yes.
There was not much said about Fourier integral. Was that an extension which happened in the 20th century more than in 19th century?
No, you see, the problem was informal methods of Fourier integrals were there, but the problem was the theory of integration formally had to wait for Lebesgue. That is, you see, Riemann developed definite integrals, Riemann integrals, but which had a lot of gaps because it could not integrate many functions which are useful. And therefore, only when Borel measure came and then subsequently Lebesgue put everything in order. So that's why I said the first 35 to 40 years of the 20th century is a golden period in analysis. Yes.
Sir Prabhu, I think Professor Prabhu has raised his hand. Yes. Sir, you have to unmute.
There are all kinds of problems now for me to know.
Yeah, Prabhu cannot unmute because I think it has been.
They can send it by chat, sir.
Or you can repeat the question.
No, but we can't hear him either.
No, so you are sharing. You are still sharing the screen.
I'm sharing the screen, but I cannot hear Professor Prabhu's question.
Sir, look at the chat box.
Sir, please post your question in the chat box.
I have to close my
yes. You have to unshare the screen. Yes,
yeah. Share the screen and then go to chat.
I'm not able to see the chat. I can see somebody raising the hand.
Yeah, that is Professor Prabhu, but I don't see the message from him. Well, Ashok Rao is also online, so he says that he contributed a lot to the deciphering of hieroglyphics.
It is a huge, I mean he was, what about greenhouse effect, his contribution to geology. Phenomenal.
Jokingly, it is said that it is Fourier who opened the tombs of Egypt.
His work in Egypt the compendium that he has made about Egypt, about his Egypt work, is phenomenal. Unbelievable. Yeah.
I still don't see Professor Prabhu's question.
The thing is, I can't even unmute.
Professor Prabhu and Professor Chandrali, please post your question in the chat box.
But otherwise, a lot of people have said, thank you for the insight. Entitled with a beautiful story. Very nice.
Negative ones. Give me the negative ones.
No, there are none.
No negative ones at all, sir.
That's bad.
No, it was so good, there was no negative at all.
The negative problem was that you made it so interesting that for all future speakers will have a problem.
There is some negative one. Good. Ramna. What is that? Please.
Oh, negative was that we cannot unmute.
Yeah, we cannot unmute.
Unmute.
Yeah.
Somebody says too short. I agree.
Somebody says, can you say a few things about Fourier transform? But this is not really on mathematics. It is on
definitely. It's only about historical.
We will talk about Fourier transform in a different platform completely. If there was no Fourier, that would have happened to us by now. What would have happened? Well, normally in science, people say there would be somebody else.
Well, if Fourier was not there, probably would have got a better series than Fourier series. Who knows?
So that's not a thing. Feels proud to have studied Fourier transform for a semester, which I had not realized till now, is what somebody said.
That's all.
Yeah.
So no questions.
No questions at all. Comments and then, I think we will make a note that somebody wants to know more about Fourier transform. Maybe we should have a special lecture on Fourier transform.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Madam. Yes.
Do you like to?
I'll conclude it, sir. So the Anand Sagar University feels proud to host the 9th celebrities and celebration lecture on.
One minute, can I interrupt?
Yes, sir.
Somebody has commented. Can we have the PowerPoint?
Yes, sir.
PPT. I shall be very happy to share the PowerPoint with anyone. Yeah.
Normally, it is loaded by Professor Murthy into one of the websites.
I do that. The Bytes website.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
And also, we will give the video link for this also. The link also for the lecture.
Great. Yeah.
Close to about 195 participants were there in the attending lecture.
Yeah.
Good.
And it was well appreciated by one and all. I think one great characteristic of Professor Vital Rao, I think most of the people may not know, he writes faster than he speaks. I was one of the fortunate students who took one course under Professor Vital Rao on linear algebra. Still, I remember the class is due at 8 o'clock in the morning, and it was one of the fantastic classes we never missed. Think to listen to a legendary, a passionate teacher like Professor Vital Rao, and it requires a great amount of fortune on our part. I'm sure each one of you have benefited from his lecture today. And whenever we meet, the alumni meet, I think there will be always one reference to Professor Vital Rao about his lectures also, I think all the time. And I think he is being adored and worshipped by every one of his students at IISc. I think mostly everybody has taken in one course under Professor Vital Rao mandatorily. That's the kind of legacy or the kind of passion that he brings into the class. Okay. Over to you, Mahalakshmi Madam.
We came to the end of the section. The Anand Sagar University feels proud to host the 9th celebrities and celebration lecture on Joseph Fourier, the analyst, in association with BITES, Board of IT Education Standards, Karnataka, by Dr. Professor Vital Rao, a former professor, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. My hearty thanks to Professor Vital Rao, who took us to 18th century, then to 1920, and virtually presented the life of the famous French mathematician and physicist Joseph Fourier. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
I'm very grateful and thankful to our DSU management, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, DSU, the Chairman Bytes, Dr. K.N.B. Murthy, who brought this opportunity to DSU, and Vice Chairman Bytes, Dr. Puttamadappa, Registrar DSU, our energetic Dean, Dr. A. Srinivas, School of Engineering DSU, for their tremendous support for the successful conduction of the CAC lecture. I thank so many distinguished participants, professors, assistant professors, research scholars, students from DSU and from other institutions also. Thank you, one and all gathered here. Thank you very much.
Yeah, this entire concept has come from Professor Jamdagni. The CAC, the concept came from Professor Jamdagni. I think it's the 9th one. we are going to have a series of lectures in the month of October, November, December, and moving forward. I think we would like to cover as many lectures as possible over a period of time. Every month, we would like to have at least one.
Sir, just one comment, if I can.
Yes, sir.
Can we really make this whole thing very informal? I mean, in a sense, this formal introductions and formal thanks.
Yes, sir. We will do it next time.
Great.
Yeah, we'll do that, sir.
This is all, next time. I mean, who is not thankful to Professor Vittal Rao? Who is not thankful to Fourier for what he does? I think sometimes takes out the sting from the whole thing. It is as though there is a practice sentence saying that I'm want to thank you.
Thank you. We'll do that.
And right, we should take. In fact, many conferences like this are in fact even informal and even jocular. People make fun of each other. They pull each other's leg. I think that culture can also probably come in.
Yes, sir. We will do that.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.